It is such a joy today. And the whole atmosphere seems to be bubbling with it. As if the angels are singing. And the speciality of Hanumana was that he was an angel. Angels are born like angels. They are angels. And they are not human beings. They are born with the angelic qualities. But now you all have become angels from the human beings. It's a very great achievement of Sahaja. The qualities that are born with the angels are seen from their very childhood. Firstly, they are not afraid of untruth, falsehood. They are not worried as to what people will say to them and what they will lose in life. To them, truth is their life. They breathe truth. And nothing else matters with them. This is the first great quality of an angel. They will go to any extent to establish truth, to protect, and to protect the people who are in truth. It's such a wide range of these angels all over. So in the left side we have Ganas, on the right side we have angels, and translated in Sanskrit language or in any Indian language as Devdut, means they are the ambassadors of gods. So now you are the same. You are all angels now. Only thing, you are not aware that you are angels while they were aware from their childhood. If you know that you are angels, all your qualities will start shining through. And you'll be amazed that the quality of standing by the truth at any cost is so easily managed for you, because you have been given the right. You have been given the special blessings, the special protection from the Divine, that if you stand for the right and if you stand for the righteous and if you stand for the truth, all kinds of help to protect you will be given. Angels are aware of this. They are sure of it, they are certain. There's a certainty about it, but you are not. You still sometimes think maybe, may not be. Same style goes on. But believe me, you are angels. You have all the powers and what rights you have. Human beings cannot get over you. That's the speciality of angels, not of saints. Saints could be maneuvered. They could be tortured. They could be troubled. Incarnations may do the same. Incarnations accept it. They want to have all these penances done to them, so that they create an event in their life to express themselves in a more dynamic way. If there was no Ravana, there would have been no Ramayana. If there was no Kansa, there would have been no Krishna. So the incarnations take upon themselves the problems and also the fight with the evil. So it looks sometimes that we feel that they suffer, but they don't. But the angels are a special category. They don't take up any problems upon themselves, they just solve them. If there's a problem, it's the angels who solve for the saints as well as for the incarnations. And they are to be told sometimes that don't jump in just now. We are working out on the stage now. You will jump when we'll ask you. They are ready, standing at the door, just to jump in. So anxious. And there are fixed quantities. You can rely on them completely. For example, Sri Hanumana, as you know him as an angel, has great capacities, great powers, and it is his right to use them. And he is very aware of it. He does everything very amusingly, uses his powers very amusingly. Like he burnt the whole of Lanka, and he was laughing at it. Then he extended his tail and put it round the necks of many Rakshasas, and he was just playing with them and then flew in the air and they all were dangling in the air. So it's a playfulness of the angels also, because they're so confident. They're absolutely aware, absolutely identified with their personality, with their powers, with themselves. Here the Sahajogis sometimes don't understand that I have made you into angels. I have not made you into saints, but angels. And you are always protected. I can only make angels, I can't make saints. Saints are made by their own effort. The effortlessness doing is like Ganesha, like Kartikeya, like Hanumana. The same way you are all made with the same style. So try to understand that what I say about you is the truth. Kinds of conditionings work even through you people, though you are saints, and you don't know how to spread your wings. Still, sometimes I feel that the rebirth has taken place and they have all become like angels with wings. But as little birds, they still have to learn how to fly. But you must gain your confidence by your experiences which you have in Sahaja. As you were singing yesterday, miracles every day, miracles around you. These are done by the angels, and they try to convince you that you are one of us. Just join our company. So we have so many angels now sitting here. And why should not we think of transforming this world? And there's one more thing that you have, other than the angels, because angels do not reach the Kundalini. They cannot. They are not bothered about it. They are there to kill, to burn, to suppress, to remove all the evil people around you. But they cannot transform. Angels cannot transform. So you have a greater right than they have in the realm of God, that you can raise the Kundalini of people and you can give realization. But human conditionings are still sticking on. For example, I wore a ring the other day, and then my daughter started teasing me that, "Now, you must only show this finger all the time to people so that they see your ring." So, in the mundane human life, whatever we have, possessions maybe, powers, you see. For example, somebody is a man with some position, immediately you can make it out with his nose and lips the way they are turned upward. But the powers that you have in your possession, you are afraid to manifest them and to talk about it, to use them. Imagine with so many angels, the whole of England should get realization in no time. But we are still trying to learn what we are. Hanumana had no problem, because from his childhood he knew that he was an angel and he has to do the job of an angel. But because we were born as human beings and now we have become angels, we find it difficult to be dynamic like other angels that they were. Even your thought, collective thought, even your individual thought is powerful. And your attention is powerful. Because of this fear, or maybe the conditionings as you can call it, or maybe the ego part which is still sticking on to you, you still hang around false things. And that force, that dynamism is not expressed. We can blame anything, like we can blame lethargy to some country, ego to some country. But now you have lost your countries completely. Now you have entered into the kingdom of God. You are in a country which has no bounds, which has no limitations. And then all these conditionings that are still lingering in you shouldn't bother you at all and shouldn't upset you or deter you from doing whatever is your job. Now imagine Hanumana as Gabriel had to go and tell Maria that there's a child which is the incarnation, the Savior is going to be born to you. She was a young virgin. To break such a news, which was horrible compared to the conditionings of those days, he did it. "I have to do it, so I'll do it. If that's the order, I'll do it." Because he knew that the carrying out of the order is his nature, is built within him, and he's not going to doubt it. He's not going to wait, but just told and he does it. So a great understanding has to be within us, that we are growing within ourselves, but if we do not manifest, if we do not show our qualities, and if we do not express it in our life, in our doing, in our object, in the meaning of our life, then Sahaj Yoga is not going to spread. Nor is it going to help you much. The kind of work you have to do has no problems with it. I have problems, not you. You don't have to face problems. You go and talk to anyone, whatever you feel like. They will jolly well have to listen to you, I should say. But if they don't, they can't harm you. They can't do any harm to you. This is a very great protection you have. They cannot hinder your work. Coming to Sahaja Yoga is not what we have gained, what we have got. See, there are people who say, we've done so much for Sahaja Yoga, and what Sahaja Yoga has given us. It has given you self-realization. It has given you the angel status. I mean, you try anything else, can you get the status of an angel? You cannot. Sahaja Yoga has given you that status. So, what more do you want? It was never possible before. Believe me, impossible situation. If it was possible in any way, then Ganeshwara would not have taken his samadhi at such a young age. And Kabira would not have said, oh God, what am I to do? This world is blind. So you have that subtle power within you that you can work out on people's kundalini without even they knowing about it. But in meditation when you sit down, you must admit yourself, I'm an angel. And as being an angel, I have no attachments with anything else but with God's work. Attachments are so many still in Sahaja Yoga, I've seen it, people have. Like attachments to now, because they are married, so they are attached to wives. And so many have fallen out because of their wives' attachments. Then they have attachments to their children. And so many will fall out if they have attachments to their children. As I told you yesterday, that all the children of the world who are Sahaja Yogis are your children. You are the parents of all the children. It's not that if your child is sleeping, you cover that child. No, you cover all the children. You have to look after all the children which are lying down. Can you think of Hanumana if he was here and when the children were sleeping, it would just cover the body of one child? Because he is a universal being. So every child has to be loved the same way, cared for by you. Then there are other attachments like possessions, jobs. I have none, so I don't know what other I have. Except for when I see you so much lovingly coming to the station, then the whole heart becomes like an ocean, I think, and just starts like a big swell of a tide, like that, I see that. And then when I have to leave you, again it recedes back like a sea, which is now receding. It's something like you see the moon and the sea starts reacting to the beauty of the moon, the joy of the moon, the love of the moon. Then I see the love that is, you see, in a nest where a bird is feeding its young ones. And you see this love in the sky, then you see this love in your heart. And only thing that you can describe is the feeling of tremendous ocean of joy within you, just flowing out. The attachments do not give you capacity to enjoy that ocean. If you are standing on the shore, how will you enjoy the ocean? You have to jump into it. But you have got your anchorage onto different things, so you can't jump in. And you are so safe. You know how to swim. You know how to kill a shark. Even one sight of yours is sufficient. But because you are not aware, it is not acting. Absolutely, this is the case. I have seen people who get small positions in life and they start boasting about it. I met this and this man, I met that and that man, and this happened and that happened. You feel like laughing at the person, I mean. But you have met Sahaja Yoga, by which you have grown, you have been nourished, you have become so great. With all this, we have to follow the line of Hanumana. He thought the sun is very egoistical. Trying to burn people, sometimes it gives too much heat. And the sun worshippers also are egoistic. They have so much ego in them. Any word, if you say wrong in their language or in their custom, say you hold the fork in a wrong hand, finished. You are the worst person in the whole world, committed the greatest sin. All such small, stupid ideas come out of a very depraved ego. Ego is so depraved. When you start thinking no end of yourself, that I am everything, and I know everything, and this custom is the best, or that carpet is the best. I don't like. But who are you? Who asked you to like it or not to like it? I don't like this. I don't like that. On the other side, the egoist always becomes slaves also. I must say that after going through the countries which are following certain norms, which are dictations of the ego. Like an artist now, for example. An artist produces something for his joy, but he must be criticized by everyone. The criticism should be, I don't like this, this color is no good, that is not. And you have professionals who do this. They don't know how to even draw one pencil line properly, leave alone painting anything. But immediately they say, I think this is, you see, this. They have made books out of it. Theses and theories. I mean, art has something to do with your heart and not with your brain. That's how you have killed so many artists. And everybody who is painting has to think what people will say about this. But as a result of that, something absolutely absurd, gross, without any subtle expression, is today appreciated. This is because of our ego, which has suppressed every proper, spontaneous, living growth of our thought, of our art, and of our life. I think it's worse than all the contamination we talk about, or ecological problems. It's the human mind which has produced these suffocating areas, where nobody can express anything. And the one who has a greater ego dominates. this book has been written by such and such person. You meet that person, you feel like jumping in the sea. So everything written is not a Bible, and those mostly who write are people whom you should never meet without a barge pole. So anything that is expressed, you see, say in a dress or in relationship with your children, in relationship with your teacher, relationship with anyone, has to be so and so and so. You must say thank you many a times, you must say sorry many a times. So we are so much curbed into artificial expressions that I think after some time there will be no art produced. There is no exuberance. They cannot, they are afraid. I don't know if you have noticed this or not, but those who go to see any museum or go to see any exhibition, anything, think all of them to be great, some divine personalities, that they can judge everyone. Through the agya that we judge, that is what Hanumana wanted to eat once for all. There's a movement of the agya which goes right and left, you see, which makes us express our so-called nonsensical personality of our ego. It's the one that he tried to control and eat it off. As I eat bhoots, perhaps he was eating this sun. But for an angel it is important to know that there is no ego within you. There are some such yogis who say, Mother, I didn't want to do too much of such yoga work because my ego will come up. Many. I don't want my ego to express it. But why do you want your ego to be destroyed? For what? For such yoga work, isn't it? What a vicious circle it is, that we say that we want to keep ourselves in the background because our ego should not develop. You are just thinking about yourself. What about Sahaja? So nowadays the trend is, oh, better be on the safe side. Because they have seen some people who were very egoistical, who were very dashing about Sahaja, who tried to show off, had to fall. So the another trend has started, I feel, in Sahaja Yoga, that better be on the safe, you see. Between these two, Sahaja Yoga will be lost. So if you know you are angels, you will have no ego. Anybody who knows that is his nature to do something, like today my husband was praising me, saying that it is you who has done it. I said, not me, it's not me. He said, how do you say it? It's not true. Because, I said, it is innately built in them, a seed. If it is planted in the Mother Earth, then it sprouts. In the same way they have innately built within them, their kundalini just sprouts. So how is it I have done? But he said, but the Mother Earth has done it. I said, no. It's the quality in Mother Earth which is built in has done it. So he said, then who has done all this? So I said, it's done by Adi Shakti, agreed. But Sahaja Yoga is not done by Adi Shakti. She has created these powers in everyone which works out. But Sahaja Yoga is not. Sahaja Yoga works through the innate qualities that are in the Mother Earth and that are in the seed. So I'm here as, not as Adi Shatru, I'm here as their mother, as their Holy Mother. And as Holy Mother, I've guided them. You can say I'm like the Mother Earth who sprouts the seeds. So then another detachment can come into you.